Okay, I'll accept.
Good morning, Valentina. Welcome to this conversation about Abruzzo and your winery. How are you doing?
I'm fine, thanks, Paul. Good morning to you too, and glad to meet you.
Yeah, so, absolutely.
Yeah, and looking forward to have our conversation about the Abruzzo wines and our winery.
Yeah, I'm very excited about this conversation, to be honest, because Abruzzo is a region I feel has been kind of, you know, left out of the discussions a little bit, you know, in terms of Italian wine in recent years. So, I'm looking forward to kind of catching up. But how about we start, maybe just sort of briefly introduce yourself and your winery and what you do there.
Yeah, okay. So first of all, Paul, thank you for this opportunity, actually, to talk about our wonderful territory and, of course, the work of my family winery. I am Valentina Olivastri, and from Olivastri Tommaso Winery, which is the winery that has been owned and started from my family since 2000, from my parents, and today going on with the fourth generation of grape growers and second in the winery with me, and I have two sisters too. So we are now, everyone is joining the winery work. And we are located in Abruzzo, of course, in the province of Chieti, which is the southern province of Abruzzo. And in particular, our winery and our vineyards are located along the Trabocchi Coast, a place of Abruzzo that is known as Trabocchi Coast. So very close to the sea area, and the sea influence highly characterizes then our production from an agronomical point of view, and of course from the wine peculiarities then.
Okay. Ours. Fantastic. So, yeah. Okay, let's talk a little bit about Abruzzo in general, because as I said before, it feels as if it's got this reputation for kind of inexpensive bulk wine, and that kind of storyline has been driven by Montepulciano and the fact it's, you know, great value and very fruity and easy drinking. But that, do you feel that's unfair? Is that's not quite the full story, is it?
Yeah, actually, the Abruzzo, first, Abruzzo territory is, of course, located in the central part of Italy, for ones who does not know the location of our region. And we are known to be on the opposite side of Rome. And that's, of course, right. So we border north with Marche, south with Puglia, and west with Lazio, where is Rome. And the Abruzzo is highly characteristic because we have close distance from the mountainside and then the seaside. And all the viticulture area are located in all this stretch of territory, a mountain area of cultivation, a hill area of cultivation, that then gently goes into a sea area of cultivation. And of course, they are quite close, but there are differences in the territories of cultivation, and each side has its peculiarity. So in Abruzzo, for sure, we have to keep in mind that even if we have for example, in the Montepulciano that you were mentioning, in the Montepulciano d'Abruzzo wine are represented different areas of cultivation of the region of Abruzzo. And each one has its peculiarity. But what for sure I can agree with is that the Montepulciano has been known as, you know, a very good price point wine, with the easy drinking, but we know that actually the authentic personality of Montepulciano d'Abruzzo wine starts from considering the characteristics of the Montepulciano grape. And the Montepulciano grape, if you follow a quality kind of cultivation, shows a very peculiar profile in its composition and so in the wines that you can get from, that is highly characterized from being a really expressive, powerful, and you know, in the Montepulciano you can appreciate also a high tannic composition, but if you give the wine a controlling the quantity of production in vineyards and the right time in the winery, You will appreciate a great complexity in this wine, and also a very pleasant elegance, and also an intriguing kind of profile. So we think that the Montepulciano is not an easy kind, you know, very drinkable kind of wine. But if you work by being careful to keep its most, its better profile of expression, controlling the quantities of production, you can get back a very complex and expressive kind of red wine that also can give a good value to the expression of the territory potential of Abruzzo, since you really appreciate the structure and the enveloping taste that this red wine from Abruzzo can have.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. I think it is one of those great varieties that does seem to give very sort of pleasant, pleasing aromatics and sort of structure. And as a result, it's become quite commercially successful, right? But actually, as you say, with a little bit more, control in the vineyard, a little bit more control in the cellar, you can actually create a very, very complex wine. Now, from what I can tell in Abruzzo, things are slowly moving towards more kind of terroir thinking, right? We have, there's one Doc G already, but we're talking about the establishment of Casauria as another DOCG for Montepulciano. Can you talk to me a little bit about what's happening in the region and what producers in general think about Montepulciano's potential to express certain geographic interpretations?
That's like a ferment in the region, because Montepulciano is for sure one of the most ancient grapes, and so then wines, that has represented Abruzzo. And also the DOC is one of the earliest one that actually in Italy we have had, because if I'm not wrong, it's on the 1968, the DOC of Montepulciano. So we have had a long way, and in the meanwhile, many different things has changed in the Abruzzo territory. Different wineries started producing their own wines, and so reflecting the peculiarities of their single territory. So for sure, when it started with the DOCG, that better represented the personality of the Teramo province, Montepulciano d'Abruzzo, the direction today, for what we can see, is that we will probably go in the direction of giving value to each single peculiar micro territory. And that's quite good, because as I was saying in the beginning, behind this DOC, single DOC of Montepulciano d'Abruzzo, we have inside many different kind of territories. So it's I think that it's also good to represent differently each single one and understand how this common grape variety, very well adapted in our region, can reveal something different and something peculiar of each single different territory, of course. So every producer is for sure working to get a better quality in the Montepulciano wine. And that's something that we absolutely feel in the, production of Abruzzo wines in general, but particularly on the Montepulciano, everyone has understand that if we work better, we can have a better, again, value for the image of this grape variety that keeps behind the potential of our territory. So everyone is trying to understand how they can get better representation in their Montepulciano d'Abruzzo wine.
Mm-hmm. Brilliant. Okay, so I want to come back to Montepulciano and specifically how it grows in your own family vineyards in just a second. But perhaps just finally, before we do that, let's talk a little bit about some of the white grape varieties that grow in the region. Obviously, we've got Passerina, Pecorino. you know, these grape varieties have seen tremendous, you know, growth over the last sort of 10 years or so. How do you feel about them?
Oh, I think that, you know, the until 20 years ago, probably, if you say white wine Abruzzo, we had only Trebbiano, which is, again, at the same time of the red Montepulciano, Trebbiano is the most ancient and historical white grape variety and wine from Abruzzo. And it is very appreciable for the equilibrium and also the harmonic balance and the longevity that, as the Montepulciano, they can show along the time. But we have other these other grape varieties that you have mentioned, so the Pecorino, Passerina, and Cococciola, that also in our vineyards we are growing in our properties, they were still ancient grape varieties of Abruzzo. And the reason why we have not cultivated them anymore is that they were producing lower quantities if compared with Trebbiano. So in ancient times, everyone was caring, you know, to have 100% they can from their lands. But now in the recent, in the last 20, 15 years, particularly, you know, who wanted to look for something to bring back tradition has replanted back in their vineyards these other three grape varieties. And we have been then observing the results and the quality that we came back from them. And they are very interesting because every one of them shows a completely different personality, starting from the Pecorino, that is for sure the more powerful white wine, so very, very expressive of each territory where it is then cultivated. It shows very well the characteristics of the territory. Then we have also Passerina, that is interesting for the pleasantness of this wine, a very easy drinking wine. So for example, I would say in the summertime, you can really appreciate a good glass of Passerina, and showing a nice freshness too. And the last one we were mentioning is Cococciola. And the Cococciola is a more peculiar kind of white grape, since it is not cultivated in all the provinces and the areas in general of Abruzzo. For sure, not so much in the mountainside. It is mostly, its cultivation is mostly focused in the Chieti province, for sure, and something in the Pescara province too. And about the Cococciola, someone prefers then to use this grape variety to blend some other wine, because the peculiarity of Cococciola is to be very fresh. It has a more remarkable acidity compared with all the other whites that we have. So that's how you can appreciate this grape variety. You can use to blend and give a touch of freshness, for example, to a white wine that you produce, or you can do another choice to appreciate that wine on its own, so 100% Cococciola. And we are not so many wineries, but we are a group of wineries that bottles the Cococciola wine right on its own. And we have 100% one. And for this wine, you can truly appreciate the freshness and the easy drinking of this wine. Is a nice, organoleptic profile, because the remarkable acidity makes it very pleasant and cleaning when you drink it, but it's not structured. So you can easily drink more than a glass of wine, you know, and pairs very well actually with the seaside, also gastronomical tradition here, and gives a good value to the Chieti territory, because as I was saying, is mostly bound to the Chieti province, and something goes like a unique gem from a micro territory of Abruzzo, so still something to give a difference, something different from Abruzzo viticulture.
Yeah, I think they're three fantastic grape varieties, and of course they're gaining popularity every year. You know, more people are discovering them, and I think that's a trend that we're going to see continue for quite a long time. They're really good grapes. Thank you for indulging me in that little overview of the Abruzzo region. Let's talk about your you know, your family winery in detail a bit more. Obviously, the Olivastri name has been around for, you know, 120, 130 years or so, hasn't it? So could you start at the beginning and take us through the family tree?
Yeah, sure. Our winery, Olivastri Tommaso, is the name of my father. So he gives the name to the winery because in 2000, he, with my mom, started having the winery to make our own wine from our own grapes. And even if our history as wine producers is 22 years old, but in my family, we have been, for sure, from my great-grandfather, generations of viticulture, and we had also some olive trees, but mostly the work in my family has been always focused on viticulture. So my great-grandfather was a farmhand. He was named Tommaso Olivastri, as my father too, so names coming traditionally in the Abruzzo families. And he was a farmhand here in San Vito Chietino, which is our small town. And then with the generation next, so with my grandfather generation, Antonio Olivastri, he emigrated in Canada. And he emigrated mostly because he wanted to earn money to buy some lands and move from the farmhand condition to, you know, having their own family, azienda agricola, so their own vineyards that they can cultivate and survive economically on their own with their own properties. So that was a project that also my great-grandfather had, because he emigrated in Boston for the same reason, but he had to come back because he was involved in fighting in the First World War. So he had to come back to Italy very early, after a couple of years, and he didn't have the opportunity to make this change of, you know, condition. And my grandfather managed to do this. And in fact, my father also born in Canada, because he was born in the years that my grandfather was working there to send back money and buy through his father the lands. So still in San Vito Chietino. So our family history as grape growers is also strictly bound to a very limited area of cultivation, San Vito Chietino and all around. So today we have also a great knowledge about the territory we are working on. And this is quite precious when you make a quality focused, you know, agronomical work, since we perfectly know the characteristics of the soil, the peculiarities. Also, if you move a couple of kilometers, you can have different conditions. So that's something that we have carried on in our family work, and we still have today. And it's, you know, really, really precious for us.
Okay. And so today, how many hectares do you cultivate, and across which grape varieties?
Oh, we have today 12 hectares of vineyards. When my father in the 80s handed down the properties from his father, he spent around 15 years to change, you know, the philosophy of training the vineyards from a quantity kind of production that my grandfather was mostly following, from a quality kind of grapes production, because he was convinced about the potential vocation in a good expression of our territory. And that's why when he had in his hands the, you know, the conduction of the azienda agricola, he changed the philosophy. And so in that moment, in that years, from the family vineyards, he bought also something more, particularly a single piece of vineyards that today we still have as Lariosa vineyards, that are very, very close to the sea, with a really different kind of soil composition from, for example, the hillside area, where we cultivate today the Pecorino, Passerina, and Cococciola grape variety. So they have been bought from dad in the early 90s, And then gradually he joining, you know, the private wineries, keeping back these ancient grape varieties, he experimented planting one by one in this vineyard close to the sea, because the conditions there were really better to grow this kind of grape varieties. So in our winery today, in our 12 hectares of vineyards, we have also made a specific different allocation for the different grape varieties, concentrating the three white grapes that I have mentioned now in the seaside area, and instead the Montepulciano and the Trebbiano grape varieties are cultivated on the hillside area of San Vito Chiatino, where we have mostly a different kind of soil composition, that is clay here, mostly a clay soil with, we say a dark soil, because the minerals in this clay soil, it's typically tending to iron and to a micro elements also composition that is better to grow these two different kind of grape varieties. So, and the different allocation we have seen along these years is very important in the quality that you can then reach in the grapes. So that's why I was saying that the experience handed down from family is very, very important. And and that's the, all our vineyards get the traditional Abruzzo training system of the Pergola Abruzzese. So we call here also tendone, because it's a horizontal development of the leaves that develops up and completely then covers the top of the soil. So, and also the vines are have more distance between each other if compared, for example, with the typical row system that you can also see here in Abruzzo. And
can you talk a little bit about, you know, the effect, the impact of that training method? You know, what are you trying to achieve by doing that, and where did it come from?
Oh yeah, sure. Yeah, the Pergola Abruzzese, my dad has never wanted to change it, because it has a very open range of positive aspects if you want to grow quality in your vineyards. Because first in the Pergola, you have the leaves covering up filters the ray of the sun coming. And particularly in our seaside area, where we have a lot of sun, of course, when the ray of the sun comes and the leaves filters it, it avoid, the pergola system avoid to have a direct and too much intense impact of the sun only on a face of the gray. So the ray that is filtered goes in a more homogeneous distribution in the same way in all the surface of the grapes that we are growing behind the vineyard. And so that's very, very important, because the maturation is reached homogeneously in all the grape, and also slowly. That means that we develop by the end a more elegant profile, meaning in the composition of the grape, that gives a more elegant than taste, particularly to the wine. So that's for sure a first point, really important, to have a filtration of the ray of the sun coming. And of course, also the having this, you know, the shadow behind the vineyard, because in the summer months, the leaves covers completely the, you know, the top of the soil, they also create a different microclimate behind the vineyard. So the grapes are not living the same temperatures that we can have outside the vineyard, but when you go inside, so behind your vineyard, just walking, you immediately feel that you are 2-3 degrees lower, cooler than the outside. So it preserves also from a thermal stress that you can have on your grapes, particularly now with the climate change. This is being very, very helpful for us. And the third point that I would say is the main, one of the main positive aspects of having the pergola, is that Also, the soil, of course, keeps the shadow, and the water evaporation in a sunny place where we are is highly controlled from having this shadow. And in fact, even when we are experimenting in last years, these drier and hotter summers, our vines are not suffering, you know, so much, for sure, because they produce low quantity, but also because the soil is in shadow. And so the water evaporation is better controlled by having the pergola. So that's for sure another important point to keep also equilibrated conditions to the vines that will then grow your grapes. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And obviously these are difficult and challenging times, you know, in terms of climate change, aren't they? I mean, we're recording this at a time where Italy, perhaps not necessarily Abruzzo, but certainly further north, is experiencing, you know, terrible drought problems. So it's interesting to hear, you know, how these perhaps more traditional trellising methods are actually turning out to be quite a useful defense against these changing temperatures and freak weather scenarios. Okay, I'd like to move on actually to just talk about your wines specifically. You know, perhaps you can point the audience towards two of your favorite wines that you would recommend people taste to get a good understanding of your winery.
Yeah, oh, that's always a difficult question, yeah, because we love all of our grape varieties and all of our wines, but for sure some can express really well our territory and also our work. First, I would say that our work as wine producers is lived always keeping in mind that we love being grape growers, because our winery is characterized as an artisanal winery with a family, still today with a family kind of conduction. So this means that we are experimenting first person, the work in the vineyards, and then the work in the winery, and then of course the moment of sharing our wines. So it's 100% of our work, but what we Dad since the beginning has been very passionate too, and we have handed down this passion, is just the work that you do in the vineyard. So if you love that, it conditions your thought about how then you want to work in the winery. And that's why since the early years when my father started, we have always had a genuine kind of wine production. That means that we are keeping our grapes from the vineyards and in the winery, following, you know, traditional, but also careful to, you know, some innovative, for example, instrument, for something that we can follow to have the best preservation of the natural peculiarities that comes from our grapes, and have them carry them with our care into the winery to become a very expressive wine that keeps inside the, you know, authentic taste of this territory, of our human experience, and also, of course, of the each single grape variety peculiarity, because you can really feel the differences, particularly in the four whites that we produce. You can truly feel the different personality of each one of them. So we are not standardizing our wines. We don't like to do that. We are careful in keeping, you know, very clean conditions, very doing the right, for example, working processes in the right time, but always in order to, you know, just have a natural and on its own expression of the wine becoming. And this has allowed us to also learn understanding the personality of each different grape variety and how then they express the peculiarity of our territory. For sure, in our wines, all of them are characterized always from having a good freshness, because we are very close to the sea as a location. And the sea influences a lot the composition of our soil, that for example, the sandy soils has come from the sea that has get back. So we have a lot of, mineral, also sea minerality in that soils. But also here in the hillside area, we have 2 meters of clay soil, and then below a kind of soil that is still influenced from being up on the sea. So we have good acidity just coming from, the trauma, the composition of the soil, that makes all our wines always very fresh. They are always very tonic kind of wines. And then another thing that we can find in general in common in our wine is a good expression of the minerality that we still have in our place. And then being in a warm area, we have always a rich concentration of the peculiarities that characterizes the grape variety. And since we are not, interventing then on the organoleptic profile of the wine, you will find them back well expressed in the wines coming. So for sure, I would say that in the whites, you can appreciate, for example, the Trebbiano, that is the only one that we have here on the hillside area, for its very unique kind of equilibrium. So the Trebbiano is something for us unique for that reason. But I have to say that this can be appreciated if you, again, produce low quantities in the vineyards. Otherwise, you will just lost something of this. And so that's something that you can also have versatile pairings, because it's a very delicate but balanced kind of white wine. And Cococciola, as we were saying before, is a kind of wine that you should taste, because it's quite a unique expression of our territory, mostly bond right to our places, so revealing a very fresh and pleasant taste that makes you have also interesting pairings with here we pair a lot with the raw fish, for example, and we are on the sea, so we have a lot of fish, different recipes. But you can also get good pairings with, any kind of food or of cooking that can have a more fat kind of sense in the palate. Because when you drink this wine, you immediately realize how it perfectly clean your mouth. So you can truly appreciate this unique taste of it. Within a not so much structured, is very delicate again as white wine. In the whites, the Pecorino is always, we say, is always the wine that expresses more. It's like a concentration of our everything, because the Pecorino grape variety is characterized from having small berries, a lot of concentration, and in the wines, from the aromatic profile to the structure and the enveloping taste, you can clearly feel it. So it's something very, for us, very nice. One of for sure, of the best representation of the territory and of our work. Mm-hmm. And tell me, Paul.
I feel like you're going to list every single wine you do as your favorite, which is exactly what, what you said you would do. No, I'm joking. I think, I agree in terms of Cococciola. I think you've done a wonderful description of the variety. That's the way it behaves in the glass has certainly been my experience of Cococciola. Go on. Let's finish with your Montepulciano's. Tell us a little bit about those.
Yeah. With the Montepulciano grape variety, then, which is from Abruzzo, the most known and the only, the prince of the red grape variety, we get not only the red wine, but also the rosé wine of Cerasuolo d'Abruzzo, which is a more recent DOC, but again, a very traditional wine. It was the daily wine of the, particularly in the peasant tradition, So we take also a lot of care in the Cerasuolo d'Abruzzo wine production. And in our winery, we produce from 100% of Montepulciano grapes with a white vinification. So immediately separating the skins from the juice. But in our seaside area, if you work with this white vinification, you can get a very equilibrated and with a lot of personality Cerasuolo wine. And the Cerasuolo wine is has gone under an increasing appreciation and also quality level in the Abruzzo producers. So that's something that I would recommend to try among the Abruzzo wines for sure. And then we have two different bottles of Montepulciano. And one of them, whose name is La Grondaia, is the Montepulciano wine that we age only in still. And that can let you appreciate the authentic taste of Montepulciano cultivated in our area, following, you know, a quality goal. The other bottle is of Montepulciano d'Abruzzo wine is named La Carrata. And this wine, after 30 months of aging in still, is also aged in barrels, so a different environment of aging that brings in the Montepulciano wine a very enrichment in the complexity, in the, you know, in the velvet tannic perception, and in general in the elegance and in the taste that you can develop in the Montepulciano wine. So it's like, you know, the higher point of the evolution that you can have in the Montepulciano wine, of course, in our winery, because we are using only still aging and barrels aging, and then the bottle aging for the Montepulciano wines for sure. So it represents a different way to appreciate Montepulciano. But what I want to underline about our way of then producing the Montepulciano wine is that since the very beginning, we have never bottled young vintage of Montepulciano, because my dad was convinced that Montepulciano is not a wine properly to be drink in very young vintages. And mostly if you work with low quantities of production in the vineyards that concentrates a lot, if you drink the Montepulciano in a young time, you won't appreciate its best potential of expression. So that's why since the first vintages we have had from two, now we have 3 years of aging of the wine into the winery, and then we bottle it. Because we have seen that in that moment, you can start appreciating it from a very good moment of appreciating then the personality of the Montepulciano. So keeping it genuine with no, you know, not making it artificially round, you have a natural balance that is got from the wine, just from giving it the time to let this equilibrium be naturally rich, from the aroma that becomes very intriguing in the fruity notes that you can find, to the taste that it's something very, very elegant and balanced, really. But still showing then a good longevity, because if you would like to think about keeping the bottle of Montepulciano for some years longer, you absolutely can do it, yeah.
Yeah, that's interesting. That ties in with our early conversation about, you know, is Abruzzo just, you know, this source of inexpensive Montepulciano to be consumed young? Actually, not at all. You know, there's yourself and lots of other producers that are making these complex wines that are required and deserve to be aged for a long time in order to you know, extract that complexity and you know, and that you know, that kind of intriguing soft structure that comes with time. So Valentina, is there anything you want to add? Is there anything you want to tell people about before we say goodbye?
Oh, we got a good and quite complete conversation, Paul, but for sure I would say that who would like to try our wines, what we care mostly to let people then find in a glass of our wines is just the authentic expression of our terroir and of our human experience, because everything in our vineyards is done by hand, and so there is also experience from that, you know, history in working from when he was 15 years old, he started joining the work in the vineyards. So he loved that job. And there is a lot of knowledge in any of the procedure that we do in the vineyards. So that's something that you can then find back in our wines. So, and also if anyone has the opportunity to visit our territory, for sure would understand and would find the peculiarities also of Abruzzo territory. Yeah.
Great. Okay, well, Valentina, thank you for your time and thank you for providing that little snapshot of the region and the grapes and your winery. As you said, I hope people can go and visit you and see what you do there. And until next time, have a great day and good luck for the coming harvest.
Oh, thank you, Paul. We are because I think in 1 week we will definitely start harvesting the Pecorino, which is the earliest grape variety. So absolutely, we will harvest very soon. And thank you for this pleasant conversation and again the opportunity to talk about all of these things that we have shared together.
No problem. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Paul. Bye. Ciao.